Good morning, everybody. Thanks for joining us on this Sunday morning. My name is Charlotte, and you may remember me encouraging you to come by to pick up one of these Skittles back-to-school prayer sheets. Well, today we want to highlight several of our Broadway teachers as they prepare to return back to public school. So grab a pen, a paper, and get ready to make some notes because we asked them, what are your top prayer requests heading back into school this year?
Good morning, Broadway. I'm Brad, and as I head back to school this fall, I've thought of some ways that you can pray specifically for me. Thank you for doing that. I'm going to be starting at a new and a larger elementary school this week at Sardis Elementary as their vice principal. And that means a lot of newness in my role there. New staff, new students and families to get to know, and new procedures to learn and follow. In a staff of more than 60, I will be only one of three male staff members there. So that will be kind of interesting. So more than just prayers for my energy and my enthusiasm in building relationships, my hope is that you could pray specifically for me that I would be able to model some of the qualities of Jesus in the new setting that I'll be placed in. First of all, that I could demonstrate the quality of patience in stressful situations that will undoubtedly come my way. And compassion for those who may be sandpapery, if I can say that. And above all, just a genuine love for people throughout the day. And that God would send me reminders throughout the day that all people are made in His image. And so if you could pick up on some of those things that I've said here today and pray for me in those ways, I would greatly appreciate it. Thank you so much.
September usually brings changes. Well, always brings changes. There's meetings, new faces, new names, developing relationships with parents and students with special needs. But this year brings just a whole new host of uncertainty. And so I would like prayer for a real calm center, that I would be stable, just emotionally stable to handle those changes. That's my number one prayer request. And that I would be able to build relationships with my students in spite of restrictions, and that I would have a sense of creativity to deal with whatever comes my way.
I have two main prayer requests this year as we go back into September. One being in regards just to the chaos going on around us and the lack of control we feel about the situation. I know one thing I always have control over is how I respond. And so one prayer request would be that I pray I would be calm, safe, and a helpful presence to the kiddos who walk through my door, to the anxious parents I interact with, and to the overwhelmed colleagues who need help. I get to choose how I respond each day, and so I pray that I would be calm and just a light in the situation around us. And second, this year I'm going to be a learning assistance resource teacher, so working with kids specifically with exceptionalities. And so these are the kiddos who may struggle even more this year. And my prayer is that we would not leave them behind. With all the new rules and routines and procedures, these kids may struggle with sensory issues and wearing a mask or understanding the need to wash their hands. And there may be so many more barriers for them to their learning. And so I just pray that I and other educators would work diligently to remove those barriers and to support the kids and their families to the best of our abilities. So thanks for your prayers and thanks for your support, Broadway.
Hey, good morning, everybody. This is Steve Anderson, or Mr. A, if you're somebody that's in a school with me. So I was asked if there was any prayer requests that I had for going back to school. And there is one. There's a bunch. I mean, there's a truckload. But the one that might be really, really important, I think, is that we pray that students and families won't be overly consumed by anxiety and stress. There's just an awful lot of stuff that's not known right now about what the school year is going to look like. There's plans, but they're all completely different than anything that's been done in the last 50 years. So reduced stress and some faith, people can pray about that. That'd be great, because we know that when people are stressed out and anxiety is running wild, people don't learn anything. They don't learn very well at all. So calm spirits would be great. Thanks.
So aside from the teachers that you saw, we also have Jen and Mike Beauchesne, who both teach elementary, Vanessa Weens, the kindergarten teacher who is currently on maternity leave, and Tim Jans had a bit of an unceremonious retirement from teaching this past June, but he's going to continue to be in the trenches as he supports Sylvia as she teaches the elementary school students. So now we know how to better pray for all of these teachers and members of our church family, and all the teachers. There are many, many, many school employees who probably don't have strong supports in their lives. And those teachers, the EAs and other staff, they speak directly into our kids' lives and into the parents' lives too. So speaking of kids, we hope to share a little update of all of our Broadway students heading back into schools soon. Stay tuned.
It's your breath. my Father, there is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions they fail not, as thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy and love. Beginning to end, my life in your that endureth, thy own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings are mine with 10,000 beside.
Good morning, everybody. My name is Michelle Greenwood, and my husband John and our two kids, Zachary and Alexis, have been attending Broadway for about 7 years now. Things have been going pretty well these past few months. I would say my low point was back in March when I started to hear rumors that there was no bread and no milk in Chilliwack. I really started to panic, and I had to turn to God and remember that He would provide. My strategy during these times have been to stay busy and to tire out my kids. We've played lots of board games. We found a new love of puzzles, and we've been taking advantage of our beautiful city and doing lots of hikes and lots of bike rides. My kids are up to 22K bike rides, so that's awesome. Thankfully, my husband John is a truck driver, so he's had pretty consistent work over the last few months, which has been great financially, but it also has made me worry a few times. I've worried about his health, I've worried about his safety, but I always remember to turn to God and go to Him in prayer, and He gives me the reassurance that I need. Please bow your heads and join me in prayer this morning. Dear Heavenly Father,
We come before you this morning with open hearts. It is such a transitional time for everyone, and I ask that you be with us as we enter this new season. There are so many decisions that each of us are having to make almost on a daily basis. I ask that you remind each and every one of us that you are with us every step of the way. Please give us wisdom. Only you know the right choices for us and our families. Remind us to be still before you with quiet reflection. We thank you for your goodness. I pray for our lead team as they navigate what and how much we can do as a church. I pray for the school board as they make decisions for our children, parents, teachers, and administrators. I pray that Chad and Mary Mart start to feel better soon and that they may begin their long journey home to Chilliwack. I pray that everyone stays healthy through these trying times. I pray that if there's anyone out there that is feeling lonely or isolated, that they have the strength to reach out and ask for help. On my heart today is this verse from Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart and lean not on your own understanding. In all your ways, submit to him and he will make your path straight. We just ask all these things in your name. Amen.
Hello. Welcome to our August 30th sermon. This is our final sermon in this series. And this one's entitled, Jesus Invites Us. He invites you and he invites me. Not to hypocrisy, not to pride, not to blind spots, but he invites us to himself. Because when we are not connected to him, when we don't have like the vine to the branches, we can become hypocritical, we become prideful, and we can get blind spots. So today is about knowing Jesus invites us. So if you have your Bible with you, I'm turning to Matthew chapter 23. We're going to start in verse 37 and go till chapter 24, verse 2. Jesus speaking, O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you who kill the prophets and stone those sent to you, how often I have longed to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you were not willing. Look, your house is left to you desolate. For I tell you, you will not see me again until you say, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Jesus left the temple and was walking away when his disciples came up to him to call his attention to all the buildings. Jesus said, do you see all these things? I tell you the truth, not one stone here will be left on another. Everyone will be thrown down. So here we are in this last of the seven, last part of the seven woes in chapter 23. Here Jesus speaks, not so much as the judge of all the earth, which he most certainly is, but as the lover of human souls. These verses take us to the very heart of Jesus. He realized the constant discussion of protest and insurrection of Rome would lead to a massive retaliation from the Roman authorities, and this would crush the nation before long. This Jewish zealotry would inevitably invite the heavy foot of Rome. Disaster stared Judea in the face. So in the light of that imminent catastrophe, Jesus interjects into this most painful chapter a wonderful ray of his love. Last week, we went through his seventh woe, his last woe. Remember, these woes are lament and grief and frustration and righteous anger. His love for the nation of Israel, for people, is brought home to us in four graphic ways, but two negative ones and two positive. On the negative side, he first unmasks the Pharisees in this entire chapter. He takes up John the Baptist's words and calls them a brood of vipers, but he loves them. And so he has to tell them to their face. He strips the masks off these play actors so that they may be seen as they really are. They are on the road to political and spiritual destruction. And he says, whoa. Secondly, he left the temple. He walked away. And there's no follow-up questions from the Pharisees. There's no repentance. There's no confession of the sins that Jesus pointed out to them. They had just heard the voice of God, and they did not turn to God, a stiff-necked people, just like their ancestors. That was his prediction here. His departure is the fitting conclusion to this terrible assessment he delivered of the contemporary spiritual leadership of his country. Leaving the temple is a significant gesture, for the temple was the center of worship, the focus of Israel's hopes. It was the place of divine revelation, the location of some of his most famous teachings. He was there, God was there in person. This is where the leaders of his nation confronted him and were driven to make up their minds about him, the temple. And they had made up their minds. Chapter 26, they said Jesus must die. So the Messiah leaves his temple. The Savior they have been waiting for hundreds of years, was in their midst, but they did not recognize him. You see, the temple was where God was experienced. It was the presence of God. And Jesus is the new temple. He is the person who is full of grace and truth. And Jesus is the very person of God, Emmanuel, God with us. They did not see it. They did not know their scriptures. A few years later, in 70 AD, the temple would come crashing down, and their house, the temple, would be forsaken and desolate. That's history. On the positive side, Jesus loves them. These verses here are among the warmest and most loving words he has ever recorded as using. The statement, "How often I have longed to gather your children together," indicates that Jesus probably taught in Jerusalem more often than this one trip. How often I longed. Despite the resistance and disobedience of the Pharisees and of the people in general, Jesus loves them and he continues reaching out to them. He longs to gather them to him as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings. What a marvelous image of the love and the gentleness of the Lord. Remember from last week, Jerusalem had a history of killing the prophets from Abel to Zechariah, A to Z. Jesus' final words of frustrated love embody both judgment and mercy. Your house is left to be desolate if you continue in this way. But here's the 11th hour call to repent. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Believe I am the one who comes in the name of the Lord. But they refused. So the Pharisees must choose. Jesus loves them. He reaches out to them. He said, I am going to continue to send you prophets and wise men and teachers. After I die, after me will be the apostles and followers of Jesus taking the message to people. And we read about that in the day of Pentecost in the book of Acts. He said to his followers, you will be my witnesses when the Holy Spirit arrives and you receive the Holy Spirit. Some of these Pharisees might have been hearing that message from Peter we read about in Acts. He said, I will send the Holy Spirit and he will convict the world of guilt and sin and righteousness and judgment. This is all going to happen, but you're going to kill them, he says. He is telling the Pharisees, though, I am not giving up. I will send you people after I die. But they resist. They continue to resist. They're in a dangerous position. So Jesus says, I want to gather you. Let Matthew and his fellow leaders never forget their obligation to the synagogue down the street. It will be hard. Jesus says, we need to preach to the Jewish nation. The fate Jesus sees, it's the same as previous messengers of the Lord. That he says there will be flogging by whips and crucifixion and other forms of torture and murder. That's what he says here. Jesus will send people to the Jewish leaders after his death because he is still going to be like a mother hen, longing to gather them under his wing of protection and security. It's an amazing form of expression. I am sending you, Jesus says. So even after he dies, he's going to send his followers to preach to these people. He is the author of this stream of people down through the ages, prophets, martyrs, apostles, who have come to an untimely death because of obedience to the call. He sends them. If he had said the Father sends them or God has sent them, that would be natural enough. But he claims the position of God himself as the author of this mission. The Christian disciples must never forget the Jewish mission, tough and unrewarding though it would be. It was hard for Jesus and would not be easier for his followers to continue taking this message to the Jewish people. Perhaps one of the reasons Jesus concentrated on the mission to Israel during the day of his public ministry was to set an example. that would burn itself into their consciousness. The Jewish mission might not be very successful. It would lead to persecution and not infrequently to death. That's what he says in verses 33 there. But it must be undertaken, or the heart of the Savior would burst. He loved them. I long to gather you. The time was short. That crisis of AD 70 when the temple was demolished was not far away. And then it would be too late. So this passage shows us four great realities or truths. Number one, this passage shows us the patience of God. Jerusalem had killed the prophets and stoned the messengers of God. Yet God did not cast her off. And in the end, he sends his son to his people. There is a limitless patience in the love of God, which perseveres with human sinning and will not cast people off. I have longed many times. Jesus has longed. God has longed over many years. Paul describes this exact truth when he gives us a brief synopsis of his Pharisee life and his conversion. We read this in 1 Timothy chapter 1, verses 13 to verses 16. He said, I was a blasphemer. I was a persecutor. I was like those Pharisees. I was a violent man, putting to death followers of Jesus. I am of those who Jesus spoke about in Matthew chapter 23. I persecuted and I put to death the followers of Jesus. But he says, I was shown mercy. Jesus gathered me. I was ignorant and full of unbelief, just like those Pharisees in chapter 23. Then he says, the grace of our Lord was poured out on me, abundantly spilling over, lavish decadence of mercy and love and grace. Jesus gathered him under his wing. And Paul says, this is a trustworthy saying, deserves full acceptance. Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am the worst. But for that very reason, I was shown mercy, so that in me, the worst of sinners, Christ Jesus might display his unlimited patience as an example for those who would believe on him and receive eternal life. Wow. This shows about the patience of God. And then he catches himself, verse 17. Wow! Now to the King, eternal, immortal, invisible, the only God, be honor and glory forever and ever. He just lends himself into worship when he sees the patience of God for Israel and for him. Number two, this section shows us the appeal of Jesus. Jesus speaks out of love. He does not, he will not force his way in. He stands with outstretched hands of appeal, an appeal which men and women have the awful responsibility of being able to accept or to refuse. In Revelation 3:20, he says to people, I stand at the door and knock, the door of our heart. Let me in. Matthew 11:28, he says, come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me. For I am gentle, I am humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. This is the love of Jesus. And another time, recorded in John chapter 7, he says, if anyone is thirsty, let them come to me and drink. That means thirsty for love, acceptance, forgiveness, purpose, but most importantly, thirsty for God. As the deer pants for the water, so my soul pants for you. And Jesus says, this is what it is. I will give you water for your soul. Number three, truth in this section. This passage shows us the deliberate nature of human sin. Men and women looked on Christ in all the splendor of his appeal, and they refused him. So you see, there is no handle on the outside of the door of the human heart. It must be opened from the inside. And sin is the open-eyed, deliberate refusal of the appeal of God in Jesus Christ. But grace is greater than our sin. He lavishes it on people. His grace is more powerful than our sin. Sin can be defeated and has been defeated. Even though people continue to reject Jesus, he pursues, he pursues, he goes. C.S. Lewis called him the hound of heaven. Jesus wishes to gather his people under his wings, and this recalls the image of God sheltering his people under his wings. We read about this in a few verses. One of them is Exodus 19:4, and it says in here, "Remember, Israel, the little trip out of Egypt? I carried you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself." This is what Jesus is saying. Psalm 36:7, "How priceless is your unfailing love. All of humanity finds refuge in the shadow of your wings." Jesus has got these verses in mind as he talks about gathering them. Then in Psalm 63:7, "Because you are my help, I sing in the shadow of your wings." Psalm 91:4, "He will cover you with his feathers, and under his wings you will find refuge." Obviously, it's a word picture of protection, a protective shield. Do you need a place of refuge? I do. This is the call of Jesus to us. This is his invitation. Right now, he longs for this. But as often is in the case of God in the Old Testament, Jesus' love for Jerusalem here gives way to the brokenhearted pain of their rejection. Number four in this passage, it shows us the consequences of rejecting Christ and accepting Christ. He says, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." It's us to say, "This is the Lord." There is a hope for salvation if only Israel will acknowledge Jesus to be their Messiah. Israel sinned in rejecting Jesus, and there will be punishment for that sin. Only 40 years were to pass, and as I mentioned, in AD 70, Jerusalem would be in a heap of ruins. That disaster was a direct consequence of the rejection of Jesus as the Messiah. If only the way of power and politics had been abandoned in favor of the Christian way of love, Rome never would have descended on Jerusalem with its avenging might. It's the way of love. Unless and until the people of Jerusalem utter in faith the words of Psalm 118, verse 26, they will not see Jesus again. "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." But the implication is that if they do bless the one who comes in the name of the Lord, they will ultimately receive the kingdom blessings they have rejected up to this point. At Jesus' entry into Jerusalem on Palm Sunday, the crowd shouted this from Psalm 118. "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord." And the leaders, these Pharisees, looked on angrily when this happened. And according to verse 39, Jesus pronounced judgment on those same leaders and used the same words that the crowd shouted only a few days earlier. The sinful rebellion of the leaders outlined in chapter 23 is made all the more monstrous by their official capacity. They are the official interpreters of the law of Moses. And they got it wrong. They studied the scriptures and didn't know what they said. 2,000 years ago, some of God's most zealous followers found themselves in a place they never could have imagined. These Pharisees had rigorously studied the scriptures. They were obedient to the tiniest of laws, yet they had become the enemies of God, and they were not even aware of it. They actually thought they were the ones with whom God was well pleased. But as we know, Jesus is the one who God said, "With you, I am well pleased." Pharisees wanted to kill this Jesus. The Pharisees had the best of intentions. They thought their labyrinth of extra rules and their level of obedience would be a great example for others to follow. And this was their main problem with Jesus. He did not do what they thought he should. And he did things they thought he should not do. They could not believe he would be the Messiah. They actually believed they were on solid biblical ground. And they kind of were, but they knew the scriptures, but they missed the big idea, the whole purpose of the law. We talked about this last week. That's love God, love others. Don't just look good on the outside. Don't just be concerned about curb appeal, or perhaps you've bought a car that looked really good on the outside, but it broke down a few days after you bought it. That's how Jesus describes the Pharisees, looking good on the outside, but broken inside. The Pharisees were all about appearance, but their hearts were far from God. They were blind. They were negligent. They were unclean, Jesus said. They determined who was in and who was out in the kingdom. And to them, Jesus and his followers were definitely out. Perhaps the Pharisees thought they were helping God by thinning the herd, so to speak. But they had no idea that the people they judged and condemned were precisely the people God was inviting to the party. We are all susceptible in different ways to becoming a Pharisee type. We need to know Jesus invites us to him. Larry Osborne calls this becoming an accidental Pharisees. And he writes, there's three easy steps to this. Number one, it begins with a failure to grasp the true gravity and depth of my own sin, my own unclean cup. My own personal house might have a fresh paint job, but inside falling apart and in shambles. The second step to becoming an accidental Pharisee is followed by a disgust for the sins of others. And that's what the Pharisees had. And then finally, third one is kind of a cut and paste approach to theology to justify my behavior or to excuse my behaviors. It's like the Pharisees standing up with placards, pointing out the sin of others, but not seeing their own sin, their own cup. Talking about the sliver in someone else's eye, at the same time having a 2x4, a plank in their own eye. Jesus said it that way. Making sure they didn't swallow a small mosquito, but at the same time swallowing a camel. This is how you become an accidental Pharisee. So we need to look in the mirror. Have the Holy Spirit speak to us, correct us, teach us, and to guide us. 1 Timothy 3:16 puts it this way. All scripture is God-breathed. It's inspired by the Holy Spirit. And this same Holy Spirit will guide us and teach us and correct us. We need to read and study the scripture. The Holy Spirit will lead us into righteousness, into justice, faithfulness, compassion, grace, and mercy. Jesus invites us to rest, to help, to rescue. He wants to do that for us. Our hope is not in what we can do for God. Our hope is in what God has done for us. You see, Romans says, at just the right time, when we were still powerless, Christ died for the ungodly. God demonstrated his own love for us in this. While we were still sinners, Christ died for us. This is the gospel. It is grace and mercy from beginning to end. It's a continual invitation of Jesus. For by grace we are saved, and by grace we live. By grace we begin, by grace we continue, and by grace we end. Let's live the gospel. I want to read parts of Psalm 118. And this is about the invitation of Jesus to us. So just listen with me as I read the scriptures. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. And David says this, in my anguish, I cried to the Lord, and he answered by setting me free. The Lord is with me. I will not be afraid. What can anyone do to me? The Lord is with me. He is my helper. I will look in triumph on my enemies. David took the invitation of the Lord. He says, it's better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in any human. It's better to take refuge in the Lord than to trust in any political leaders. And he says, open for me the gates of righteousness. That's the invitation of Jesus. He's got gates of righteousness he's inviting us into. And David says this, I will enter these gates of righteousness. I will give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord through which the righteous may enter. I will give you thanks for you answered me. You have become my salvation. You have become my rescue, my hope. You have given me, lavished on me, an abundance of grace and mercy. The stone the builders rejected, and that's Jesus, has become the capstone. The Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Again, Jesus invites us to this. O Lord, save us. O Lord, grant us success. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. From the house of the Lord, we bless you. The Lord is God, and he has made his light shine upon us. With boughs in hand, join in the festal procession. You are my God. I will give you thanks. You are my God, and I will exalt you. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. This is the invitation of Jesus. Let's take it. Amen.
Between us, how high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through
the grave has no claim on.
It was great to have you with us here for our August 30th service. Next week, starting in September, we're going to be going through the book of Romans. Many of you perhaps have studied the book of Romans, have attempted to study the book of Romans, and I am going to be going through the book of Romans, but in an interesting way. I latched onto a book by Scott McKnight called Reading Romans Backwards. So we're actually going to start in Romans chapter 16 and then do chapter 15 and then 14. We're going to really dig into the context of the letter. Who are the people? That'll be our first few sermons. Why is Paul writing this letter? Who is he writing it to? This will be a fascinating way to go through the book of Romans, to start at the end and work our way backwards. And so be patient with this. It'll be a little different, very different. But I really believe it's going to bring up some truths in the book of Romans we might not have seen before. So have a great week, and we'll, be prepared for next week. I have read Romans chapter 16 if you want, for fun. See you later.